I do have to stop and say in 1978, 79, I had the honor and the pleasure of serving as a law clerk to Justice Potter Stewart. It was a great year. He was a great man and a great judge who always wanted to be remembered as somebody who tried his best to get the right answer in every individual's case before him, because every case before him involved people. 3 years later, he retired from the court, and his seat was taken by Justice O'Connor. Tragically, Justice Stewart died in 1985, but I just want to say how pleased he would be at how well Justice O'Connor kept his seat for him all those years. Now, can we get the results of the poll on predicting Alzheimer's disease? And the answers are, most people would want to know. Interesting. So that's a hypothetical question today. Soon, that will not be a hypothetical question. Soon, we will be able to predict fairly accurately who in this room, at least by the time they reach upper middle age, who in this room will or will not be diagnosed with Alzheimer's disease. Now, it's said, some people think it was Yogi Berra. It appears actually to have been Danish physicist Niels Bohr. Yogi Berra, Niels Bohr. It's always hard to predict things, especially the future. That's wrong. It's really easy to predict the future. It's just hard to be right about it. And right now, looking out at this group, I could guess, predict that of the people in this room, 40 to 60 of us will be diagnosed with Alzheimer's disease. I just couldn't tell you which ones. But we're getting very close to being able to say which ones. So what I want to do in this micro lecture, first time anything about me has been called micro, but what I want to do in this micro lecture is four things. Tell you a little bit about Alzheimer's disease. Tell you a little bit about how we can predict, or how we are coming to predict, who's going to get Alzheimer's disease or not. Explain why researchers care. And then end by saying what it all means and why you should care. So let's start with Alzheimer's disease. It is a nasty, evil, vicious disease that about 10 to 15% of Americans will ultimately be diagnosed with. I should note, I am not a neurologist. Do not do anything to change your medical actions based on anything I say. I have a community property interest in a medical degree. My wife is a doctor, but she's a pulmonologist. She deals with lungs, not with brains. And also remember, there are a number of different dementias. Alzheimer's disease is the most common of the dementias, but there are other ones, and I'm just talking about Alzheimer's disease. We may not be able to predict vascular dementia, microinfarct dementia, or other sorts, but Alzheimer's disease is defined as a dementia, which literally means a loss of mind, with two specific signs. The neurons in the person's brain develop on their outsides what are called amyloid plaques, like dental, like tooth plaque, made up from a protein called beta amyloid 42. And inside those neurons, another protein called tau forms tangles. If you are demented with amyloid plaque and tau tangles, you have Alzheimer's disease. If you're demented and you don't have amyloid plaque and tau tangles, you're still demented, but you don't have Alzheimer's disease. The definition is rough. It probably over-includes some people and under-includes others, but to make any progress, you have to start with definitions. So that's Alzheimer's disease. Most people who get it are diagnosed in their 60s or 70s, some in their 80s. How can we predict who's going to get Alzheimer's disease? There are actually five different paths. We can get there in part from family history, in part from genetic variations, in part from behavioral testing, in part from biomarkers, and in part from neuroimaging. Family history turns out to be pretty significant. If you've had a parent or a sibling diagnosed with Alzheimer's disease, your risks are higher. Some of that is genetics, but families share things more than genes. They share environments, they share habits, they share diets, they share a bunch of things, and we know that the family connection is mainly genetic, but there are other things as well. With respect to genes, we know a fair amount about genetics in Alzheimer's disease. There are three genes that, if you have a mutation in one of them, are almost certain to give you early onset Alzheimer's disease in your 40s or 50s. Chief Judge of the Fourth Circuit, U.S. Court of Appeals, resigned a few years ago at age 47 because of early onset Alzheimer's disease. The good news is that's very rare. It's about one person in 1,000, so probably no one in this room, as well as the fact that many of us are past the age for early onset Alzheimer's disease. The few good things about getting older. But then there are other genes. There's a gene called apolipoprotein E, or ApoE. It comes in three flavors, ApoE2, ApoE3, and ApoE4. Every one of us has two copies of this, one from our mom, one from our dad. If you've got two copies of ApoE2, that's about 1% of us, it looks like your risk of getting Alzheimer's is close to zero. If you've got two copies of ApoE4, and that's 2 or 3% of us, your risk of getting Alzheimer's disease is 80%, 70%, 90%. It's up there, but at the normal or close to the normal age. So genetics makes a difference, but half of people with Alzheimer's disease don't have any of these bad ApoE4 alleles or the other bad genes. For them, it doesn't look genetic at all. We can do behavioral tests and see what's happening to your memory. And there are some signs. What makes it confusing is as we get older, we get what I hope I have, age-appropriate memory impairment, which is where your memory isn't as good as you remember your memory having been. So we all have that. Distinguishing between that and the first stages of Alzheimer's, or what's called mild cognitive impairment, which often leads to Alzheimer's, is difficult. But it's another piece of clue that a neurologist can talk to you, have you do some tests, and get some ideas. Then there are biomarkers, these tau and amyloid proteins in your blood or in your cerebral spinal fluid provide some clues. And finally, we can do brain imaging. PET scans can now actually see how much amyloid plaque is built up in your brain. If you're 60 and there's no amyloid plaque, you're not going to get Alzheimer's anytime soon. If you're 60 and there's a lot, the chances are higher. We don't yet know how high the chances are, but in 5 or 10 years we will, because we've just been able to start doing this testing on a wide scale. Why can we do all this prediction? Because Alzheimer's is not a quick disease. If you're diagnosed with Alzheimer's at age 70, it has been ravaging your brain for decades, or at least affecting your brain for decades, and those effects we're now beginning to see. Why are we looking? People are not trying to figure out how to do this in order to predict who's going to get Alzheimer's disease. Scientists are curious about how Alzheimer's works. And as you can see what's happening in 40-year-olds and 50-year-olds, maybe you can do something to prevent it, to stop it, or to slow it down. There are some people who are interested in who's going to get Alzheimer's for clinical trials. If you want to try a new drug, it's better to try it on people who are going to get, who are highly likely to get the disease. But the last question is, why do we care? I'm a law professor, why do I care? This is a medical issue, but it's also a legal issue. Employment discrimination, insurance discrimination, long-term care insurance discrimination. If I knew I was going to get Alzheimer's disease, I'd be really interested in long-term care insurance. The long-term care insurers would be really broke if they sold it to me at an average rate and they didn't know I knew that I was at high risk for getting it. What will we do with these insurance discrimination questions? How will this affect the family's decision about when to take the car keys away from mom if they know she's at high risk versus not? How will it affect your personal life? The next time you fumble for a name or can't remember where you parked your car, when you're 25, you forget that stuff and you say, I forgot it. When you're 60 and you forget that stuff, you say, could be the first sign. And if you know you are at high risk, how would that affect you? So those numbers actually surprised me a little. Looked to me like over 60% of you said you would want to know, and maybe 30% said you wouldn't, and 10% said you didn't. You weren't sure. Those of you who want to know, how many of you would want your spouse to know? How many of you would want your kids to know? Now, how many of you would want your employer to know? So we are learning more. We are learning at an incredible rate about how the brain works and how it generates our minds and how it changes over time. We care about brains because our brains make our minds. this knowledge, which is increasing faster, which is increasing exponentially, compared to 30 years ago, we know infinitely more about human brains and how they work than we did then. Compared to 30 years from now, we know nothing. As we learn more about how the brain works, it will throw up these issues that will cause deep personal dilemmas, as well as social questions, legal questions. Predicting Alzheimer's will be one that's coming soon, the next 5 to 10 years, but there'll be many more, which I'm happy to talk about later today. Thank you.